Okay, so in this class we continue our discussion about threshold models. We start by introducing the concept of equivalence between two different threshold models, and later in the course, in particular in week 5, when we deal with all the statistical problems of estimation of the different models we are considering, we will see that equivalence is a quite useful concept from a practical point of view. Always in this class, we will consider a multivariate extension of credit metrics. We will see that from a theoretical point of view, we are just assuming a multivariate normal, so the conceptual difficulty is not bigger than what we have seen in the univariate case last time, but now we can model dependence, and we will see that this is linear dependence. Then on the course platform, you will find extra materials with some extra examples. So let's start.
Let XD and X star D star be two threshold models with state vectors S and S star. We say they are equivalent if the marginals of S and S star coincide, and if X and X star admit the same copula C. Why is this theorem relevant? As we will see in week 5, equivalence can be used for calibration purposes. If I can define two equivalent models, I can play with a more convenient one in terms of estimation, simulation, and so on, and then be able to make inference on the other.
So we can say that two threshold models are equivalent if the two state space, the two state vectors, or equivalently, because they are defined starting from the state vectors, the two default indicator vectors are equal in distribution. So their joint distributions are the same.
In the portfolio version of credit metrics, we assume that X has a multivariate normal distribution. The quantity xi is the asset value of the ith obligor at maturity. The thresholds in D are defined according to the same methodology we have seen for the univariate case, exactly the same. Notice that we could have used a Gaussian copula and the result would be the same. Why? Because of the normal marginals. In other words, it is like we are assuming a Gaussian copula implicitly. To calibrate the variance-covariance matrix, credit matrix assumes a factor model for X. And X, I repeat, is assumed to have standard normal marginals, as in the univariate case.
So we are assuming a factor model, as the one you see on your screen, in which our vector x is equal to b times f plus epsilon, where b is a matrix of weights, f is a normally distributed random vector of factors, and these factors may represent systemic factors, industry factors, economic factors, so essentially the joint component that the different counterparty shares and that determine the value of the normalized assets. And we have a vector epsilon that contains error terms that are IID, so identically independently distributed according to a normal distribution.
Using the assumptions about the independence of F and epsilon, the variance-covariance matrix of X is given by the quadratic form in omega, the variance-covariance matrix of the factors in F, and gamma, the diagonal variance-covariance matrix of the error vector epsilon.
Please notice that thanks to the assumption that the marginals are standard normals, then the covariance matrix is also a correlation matrix.
If we define the vector of weights Bi for counterparty I, we can easily obtain Xi using the formula you see on your screen.
Now, remember that thanks to the standardization we have for the different marginals, the variance of Xi is equal to 1. Now, this allows us to easily compute the systematic risk and the idiosyncratic risk. The systematic risk is the part of the risk that we can explain using the common factors, and in fact, as you can see in the formula, this depends on the common factors. And then, always from the construction, we can obtain the idiosyncratic risk, that is to say, the counterparty specific risk that we cannot explain with the common factors.
As for credit metrics, also Moody's K and V can be generalized to the multivariate case. We can still use a Gaussian copula to build the dependence among the marginals. However, since these quantities are unknown for us, we cannot make computations. It is important to notice that Moody's K and V and credit metrics can be equivalent. How? Simply if the marginal probabilities of defaults and the correlation matrix are the same in both models.
Lee's model is a model that was introduced in 2000 and during the last crisis was even blamed as the formula that blew up Wall Street. Now, this is quite an exaggeration. On the course platform, you find some extra reading that I think are really interesting. No single model can actually blow up Wall Street. Models are, if you want, neutral. It's the way in which we use them that can generate problems. So that's why we always need to know what are the weaknesses of the models we are using. Now, Lee's model can be considered a threshold models or a survival model. In reality, we are covering it here because it's a quite famous model that can be seen as a threshold model in terms of equivalence. So we can show, and we will do that later on in the course, that this model can, under certain assumption, correspond to credit metrics.
In Lee's model, Xi is no longer a variable representing assets, but rather the random default time of obligor I. If Xi is smaller than equal to capital T, then we observe the default of obligor I. Assuming that default rates can be seen as constant over a short time horizon, possibly 0 capital T is short enough, Lee assumes that the marginal distribution of Xi is an exponential distribution with parameter lambda I. The marginal probability of default is therefore equal to Fi of capital T. In order to build the portfolio dependence, we can then assume a Gaussian copula. If the marginal default probabilities are the same, and the correlation matrix as well, then Lee's model is just another way of parametrizing credit metrics, naturally only for default risk, without taking into consideration migration risk.
So I know that for sure you're asking yourself how we can use these models in practice. We will show that, we will discuss that in week 5, so I'm just asking for your patience. I prefer to introduce all the models and later to consider the practical implementations so that it's also easier to compare them. On the course platform, for what concerns credit metrics, you will find a simpler example that should help you in understanding how the dependent structure can be used to make our evaluations. So, goodbye and thank you.